the world chair.
Your girlfriends can't call Henry.
Have just learned how to do the two. Here we go.
Afternoon, and welcome to the KUHSDenver.com Artist Nook. My name is Laura Padgett, and I will be your hostess for the next half hour, or maybe just a little over. I have a great guest lined up for you today, but leading into talking to my guest, I wanted to tell you about that piece of music. There are a lot of folks out there, jazz fans, who are familiar with that piece of music. It's by the late, great Grover Washington. And the name of that song is Mr. Magic. One of my very favorite saxophonists. He has gone on to that big band in the sky, but he certainly has really touched the jazz world. And next to Stephen Ray Watts, my buddy from Dotsero, this man comes in second as my favorite saxophonist. So I want to tell you, I picked that song today because we're talking about the wonderful art of magic with Mr. Roger Lopez, who is a professional magician. Hi, Roger.
Hi, Laura. Good to be in the studio again. Just want to thank everybody out there listening with us. It's good to be back here in the studios with Henry and KUHS Denver, one of the best places to be, one of the best radio stations to listen to.
Yes, sir. I'm not going to argue with that. I'll argue with other things, but
sure,
probably not that.
Not that.
But, you know, it's so nice of you to come and to be with us this afternoon. It's a beautiful day here in Denver, again, as I always tell you. But we're going to jump into talking about something called magic. But I also want to talk about the man, Roger Lopez.
Oh.
How did you get into this art?
Well, Laura, it's definitely been something that I've done most of my life since I was a kid. Cards were always around my family. I was, you know, woke up and played poker with my dad at the breakfast table.
Oh,
and it was always just something that was around. But I noticed young that the influence that I had on people, the impact that they experienced, the smiles, the joy, even when I was little, I recognized that it was something special, so I had to just keep going with it, and I think that's what kept me pushing to the level where I'm at today.
Right, and you are a professional magician.
Okay.
You do get paid for this. We're going to talk about that, too. But I wanted to ask you, do you have, when you talk about magic, can you tell us just a little bit about the different ways that magic is used by you in terms of this joy giving and helping other people?
Well, absolutely. I always try to give back, Laura. There's different ways. Well, you have to recognize when you have a gift, whether it's music, whether it's painting, whether it's writing a book, whatever art it is that you're doing, whatever influences your life, you have to take it to the fullest and take it to the ability to give back. And if you can't take that gift, you know, that God-given gift, to touch people, to reach people, to change people's lives. You know, you might not know what you can do for someone until you actually do it. And I do a lot of charity events. I just did a Lutheran church event where we raised money for kids to, you know, build them a playground. I mean, it was an incredible experience. It was unbelievable. You know, they did an auction there, actually, and they had a lot of different items that they were bidding off, and they had me as one of the items. So.
Oh, my. He's been bid on, ladies, and he's gorgeous. You can certainly see why. But anyway, go ahead on.
Oh, well, it wasn't a dating bid.
Okay. Oh, I parched your bacon. Well, I did. Sorry, I lost that entire piece I was here. I was building. This is a family show,
no,
Roger.
Of course.
But you tell me a little bit about this again.
Well, please. No problem. It was just to raise funds for an event. You know, I do a lot of different events that do that, but this particular one was bidding for me to show up to an event of their choosing, you know, and I was like, okay, I'll start it off small. We'll do $100 to start the bid, and it just kept rising and going, right. Went from 150 to 200 to 225 to 250 to 300, 325, and then finally 350. But the most beautiful thing about the whole thing was at the end when the gentleman that bought the bid came up to me. He's like, hey, Raj, I saw what you can do. I saw how much you influence people. Could you give your time back to this school? The school we were raising money for. So giving, it just gives back. And if you can do that for people and you can inspire people, you have to.
Oh, thank you. That is wonderful. And on this day, St. Patrick's Day,
of course.
Which of course I'm a Celt, and I've talked about that a little bit. And I just did a promo for our show. If you missed it, Uncle Henry will get it up there on the web for you to see, where I taught Henry the jig. The Irish jig. He learned it. He's beautiful. He's wonderful. He's a good dancer. So the magical time that you experience while you are presenting your beautiful gift is something you've sort of touched on. But tell me a little bit, what is magic, Roger?
Oh. Well, it has a different definition for different people, of course. You know, one person may say it's sleight of hand. One person may say it's stage magic. Another person might say it's parlor magic, you know, just doing something, you know, extraordinary, making the Statue of Liberty disappear. Is that magic? What is magic? That's a great question. And it falls into this whole aspect of being here on the Artist's Nook, is that it's an art. And in giving an art and being able to give back with art, that's the beauty part of it. I mean, there's been times where people have come to tears because of things that I've shared with them, times where they've just couldn't believe what they saw. And, you know, yeah, it might be a simple trick, but simplicity at its finest is one of the most beautiful things that you can give to people.
That's right. And simplicity done well is always better than complicated mess.
Absolutely.
That's right. So for you artists out there, you dancers, musicians, writers, magicians, fine artists, simplicity works.
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. The other thing is making yourself uncomfortable, pushing yourself to the next level. Reaching for the stars. I mean, what do you have to lose?
Yeah.
You know, if you don't push harder, if you don't make yourself uncomfortable, you know, every time I'm going for a next event, I'm pushing myself to be uncomfortable. I'm pushing for a world record right now, Laura. I'm
Tell
this
me about
close
that.
To.
Yay.
Okay, so it's been in my mind for years because I can throw cards. I can throw really, really, really high.
You can throw cards.
Throw cards, a playing card, and that's the world record currently held by Rick Smith out of Ohio. He's got 70 feet 3 inches. I have to beat straight up in the air. So I got this idea, I'm going to do it at Children's Hospital, you know, so I got in contact with a great gentleman at Children's Hospital, the Ryan Seacrest Foundation, his name's Chris Coleman, you know, I've been talking back and forth, doing a lot of things to get the event pushing forward, working with the volunteers of Children's Hospital, got to put that stuff together, got to see Boulder pushing in on this project.
Brilliant.
They're going to help me survey the actual throw, because it's really hard to difficult to measure a throw that's going, you know, 100 mile an hour or something like that,
right.
Straight up in the air. So. You know, and it's playing cards shooting straight up the side of a, you know, an elevator. So you got to think, I'm going to be doing it in the actual atrium at Children's Hospital. Try to do a big charity event. Try to get people to come out. All proceeds would go to, you know, Children's Hospital, of course. So, you know, anybody that comes out to that event, stay tuned. You can check it out at my website, rogermagic.com.
Right.
We'll be able to, you know, post that out there. But once I break that record, achieving that level of uncomfortness, because Rick Smith Jr., he's the world record holder. He's the best card thrower in the world. He's the guy you see throwing, you know, cards into watermelons, and you know, you see Ripley's, believe it or not. So he is bona fide the best card thrower in the world, and here I am, little guy from, you know, Los Angeles, coming into Denver and living out here, trying to, you know, meet to that type of standard. It's fun. It's difficult. It's a challenge. But you have to push forward. You have to reach for those stars. You have to reach to be better.
So being comfortable is not necessarily always the best thing, is it?
No, definitely not. I'm also a musician. I've played violin since fourth grade.
Oh,
I picked up guitar recently. Tried dabbling in the piano once Henry inspired me. So it was
Uncle Henry does so many things.
But that's the thing. You have to look for inspiration. You have to find it where you need to get to the next level. If you're not pushing and striving to get there and move to a position that's gonna, you know, maybe change your life, alter your life. There are people that I've met, Laura. You've had a couple guests in here that I introduced you. I would have never made contact with them.
I know.
You know, I would have never known some of these people that I've met if it weren't for my magic, for my trade, you know, and it's a beautiful thing to be able to give back. That's always been my nature. My mom always said, you better do something good with it. And I do. I try to push back. And yeah, I make money off of it when I do big events, and that's only for the corporate guys. Sorry, Harley, Coca-Cola, the Reserve Casino, just some of the names to throw out there that I've worked with throughout the years. But, you know, definitely it's a good thing to give back and achieve things. And that's in every aspect of art, whether it's music. You know, I've played solo violin pieces in front of, you know, 400 audience members, and it's just nerve-wracking.
It is.
You know, and then I get in front of an audience doing magic at the Reserve in front of 400 audience members, and I'm still just as nerve-wracked. But
I once heard, I had a dance coach once. I used to perform, and this is a day for me that is so special to my heart. Performed and competed in Irish step dance for many years, and of course St. Patrick's Day was insane, but it was so much fun. And my teacher, I used to say, no, I'm nervous, I'm not going to make this performance. And she'd go, if you aren't nervous, I don't want you on the stage, because the nerves are what make you strive to be your best, forgive yourself when you mess up, but they're also what your audience sees. They see that humanity.
Absolutely.
And that's true too, isn't it?
That's true. You know, I'm not the greatest magician in the world. I'm not the best card handler. I'm not the best at anything. I'm really good at what I do, but I'm not the best. I've never claimed to be, but you still have to do what you can do to get back. You know, there's been a lot of events. I've done things with Pinups for Charity, a great organization. They get back to families every year. Look into that, guys. You know, I've done stuff with local churches, of course. We do all kinds of events. My Sammy's Quest, a young man I've been working with for a few years, always trying to put his name out there. He's now, you know, fighting. He's been fighting cancer for a while, and he's winning the battle right now.
Yes.
And you know, I don't do much, but I show up to him and I show him some magic, and I say, hey man, you can keep fighting. You can believe. You can strive to be better.
So art doesn't always have to be, and I think this is interesting in the author's world too. I hang out with artists who want to who write because they want to write. There are some in some of the groups I have who they're professional, they make money, their names are out there. I feel like for me, and I'm hearing you say that too, and I just want to encourage and inspire other artists, no matter what your genre or what your interest is, that you don't have to be a bestseller. You don't have to be a headliner. You don't have to be a soloist to be out there doing art, because everybody's an artist, and art is not a spectator sport.
Absolutely.
Find it.
Do it.
And when you talk about some of these events, and you're talking about doing the events in the public format, but also I was very touched by what you just said about going, do you go places then and just help and kind of try to touch lives of, like, kids or people?
Every day.
See?
Every day. You know, I for the last year or so, I taught at in a different school districts here in Colorado, Adams County, Boulders County. I went to different schools.
Okay.
And I taught magic to children between the ages of six to twelve. And it's a certified program that goes through the schools, and it's just another way to you know, give children, people of our future, an opportunity. Because if you don't know who you're inspiring next, I mean, what if we don't have the next Albert Einstein because I didn't go to somewhere someday?
Yeah.
You know, if we don't have the next, you know, Lance Burton or the next, you know, Stevie Ray Vaughan or whoever, whoever it may be that has that capability, that talent. You know, maybe they just needed that one little, hey, good job.
Keep it up.
You know, that's all it takes.
It's okay. Mm-hmm. And we were talking on the phone earlier this week, kind of trying to set out the format for the show. And we mentioned that you said you weren't the best in the world.
Nope.
You said that here. And, oh, by the way, folks, I just said kids and people. Kids are people. I'm sorry. I didn't mean that, kids. They're little people.
Right.
But I'm a little people, and I'm still a kid.
I'm pretty much still five.
Pretty much five. Yeah. 5 or 6. But during the course of our conversation, we just started really connecting on the heart of an artist. And that if you don't have a heart for your art, it's just mechanical. Right.
You can do it as a job. There's been times where I did it and I was like, man, this feels like a job. I don't want it to feel like a job.
Okay.
So you slow it down. You take it one step at a time, one day at a time. Carpe diem, right? Seize the day.
You got it.
And just push forward. I mean, there's nothing more that you can do than be happy with yourself and what you do. If you're not content with your art, if you're unsatisfied with it, then you need to get to the next level. Or if you're stuck. You know, if you're at that point where you're like, well, what's next? What do I do next? Well, you look, you find places. There's so many things that you can do. I never thought I'd send half of the emails I was sending to some of the people I was doing, but it was uncomfortable, but I'm doing it.
Yes.
Because I know I have that responsibility to give back. I have the ability to change people's lives, even if it's just that little bit, that it makes a difference. You know, I've known people that have come back to me years later. Raj, I remember seeing you years ago, and I still haven't stopped talking about what you could do, right? And to me, that feels great. You know, being in the public eye, you know, has its tolls, though.
There, sure
the,
does.
You know, even as a musician or an artist, wherever you're at, you know, it affects your family life. You know, I have to thank my family for always being there for me, always pushing me to achieve my dreams, and supporting when they didn't want to. So, and that's truth. You know, I try to push. I've got my son Eli, who's amazing. I want to, you know, when I leave this world, you know, tomorrow's never promised. When I leave this world, what am I going to leave for him?
Yes.
You know, was my daddy a great magician and broke a world record, right? Or was he just some guy that didn't chase his dreams?
That's right.
And I need him to know that, you know, I'm here for him. My daughter, Azariah, she's amazing, beautiful little girl. I can't wait to see what she becomes. So, you know, you have just as I, you know, I have my arts, you know, our kids will have their arts. They'll find their passions. And, you know, we're here now in the present. And, you know, tomorrow, yesterday's gone. Tomorrow is not promised. So what are you going to do then? Do it right now.
Right.
Seize that moment.
And I think the important thing that you said, well, you've said several important things here, but one of the things I really liked was no. And accept your gifts.
Mm-hmm.
And how many people go, yeah, I can do that, but I really don't. And I think sometimes, and I do this too, I fail to step into the box that says my gift isn't for me. Given to me, but not for me.
You know, what's amazing with the kids that I was teaching, you know, I worked through a great program called Strategic Kids. You guys can look them up. Great program. They give back. They do chess, Lego programs, magic programs.
Awesome.
So it's a great program. But the thing about it is it also encouraged public speaking, getting in front of the classroom and doing magic tricks in front of everybody, doing things that we could do. You know, we definitely see a lot of people that we can influence all over the world. These kids are going to go all over the world, just like all of our listeners that are coming in right now. We're in Las Vegas.
Oh, my gosh.
Germany.
Let's take a second and thank them.
Absolutely.
Good on you, Roger. Uncle Henry, could you bring the screen more forward? Yes. Well, I guess I can't. I have to count on. No, I can see it. So we have some folks in Istanbul. We do have Germany. We have all kinds of places from the United States. Hello, brothers and sisters from the United States. We have people from United Kingdom, which just went flying by. Here's Israel. And so we want to give a big shout out to the people who are listening to us internationally. This is an international show. We are at KUHSDenver.com, Artist Nook. I'm Laura Padgett, sending a big shout out. There's Canada. Woohoo! Love Canada. And my husband and I are thinking of hanging out in Canada a little bit this summer, I hope.
Oh, we've got Indonesia and Portugal and Chile, Italy. I mean, this is amazing, guys. If you guys are out there and you have an art and you're listening to us all over the world, you chase your dream.
Chase it.
Don't limit yourself, you know.
No.
Don't let anything hold you back. You chase it, you go for it, and
you
strive to be the best you can at it, whatever it may be. And, you know, once you've mastered something, find something new.
That's right.
Move forward.
And in speaking of that, and you just said you play violin,
mm-hmm.
and you do magic.
Mm-hmm.
So artists, one of the things I've learned about the art world, and I have lots of artists in my family, we cross over into different, so like being a dancer
mm-hmm.
is what took me into being a writer.
Right.
And to me, they very much, and I've written a lot on this and talked a lot about it to various people, because you have certain elements that will cross over, rhythm, beginning, middle, end, those kinds of things that you're doing, the arts kind of blend in together. One of the saddest things, I think, is when people go to their grave with their music still in them.
Absolutely. You know, it's it is an unfortunate situation to be in when this world, you know, we've got this whole international crowd right now, Laura, that's listening to us right now.
Right.
And, you know, we're in the U.S., and right now we're not the most popular country out there.
Right.
There's a lot of turmoil, not just here, but all over the globe, all over the world. And
yeah.
it takes people to take a stand and push in their arts and stand for what they're doing to make this world a better place, to take our future generations and give them something to have and achieve. I mean, what are we leaving this world?
Yeah. And, you know, I've been in international dance situations with sacred dance, with Irish dance, with competition in Vegas a few years ago, all kinds of international. And one of the things I noticed is it didn't matter if we could speak the same language.
Mm-hmm.
Our feet, that rhythm,
mm-hmm.
that art.
Absolutely.
It bound us. I think that arts are how we're going to heal our world.
And, you know, I mentioned I play violin, but I was concert master of quite a few orchestras growing up. So that meant being the leader position of
okay.
of a 150-piece orchestra group. And to make everybody work in unison, it's not always the easiest, but when everyone has the right steps, the right notations, the right music in front of them, it's possible. And the beauty of music is unreal. And it transposes into all aspects of art, whether it's painting, cards, magic, you know, whatever it is, whether it's a car that you work on, maybe that's your baby, you know, you know, that fast black car that you're flying, and you know, that's your baby, that's your art, you know, whatever it is, always reach to achieve greater goals, push yourself to be uncomfortable and give back to those that can be inspired.
Before we get any farther into this, farther, sorry, writers out there, Miss Laura gets confused, but she's old, so deal. Anyway, I just want to say, let's stop and take a moment and let's give folks information
on
how they can find you, your website, how they can hire you.
Absolutely.
Please. And also, I want to talk a couple of minutes more about some of these events that are coming up for you. So please tell us, Roger Lopez, how do people find you?
There's a few different ways.
Okay.
The most basic way right now is rogermagic.com.
Rogermagic.com.
You can find me on Facebook at Black Platinum Illusions, LLC. That's the company name that I have.
Would you repeat that slowly?
Sure. It's Black Platinum Illusions.
Okay.
Common spelling on it.
Sure.
Or Roger Lopez, if you want to take a look at that. But that's hard to get to. I'm at capacity with that one there. But, you know, there's a few places. Twitter, at Platinum Magician,
okay.
Just one M, Platinum Magician.
Okay.
And then, of course, tomorrow night I'll be at Cheers. It's a local pub that's here in town that we'll be doing a few bands coming in. Reno Divorce will be there with us tomorrow night, and I'll be on stage sharing a little bit of a stage time with them. So
with magic?
Yeah, with magic.
Or with violin?
No, with magic.
Okay, he's going to do magic. So will you be doing card tricks? What are you doing?
I'll be doing a little bit of stage, stuff.
What is stage stuff?
Well, just bringing people up on stage and having them being part of the experience.
Oh, I was thinking of going
until you
said that.
Well, you know I'd bring you on.
You know I don't like the stage,
oh,
Roger.
Well,
that's
the whole point.
No, I love it.
That's the whole point. Maybe you should come out and do a trick with
me. Yeah, maybe I should. make the little lady disappear. My husband will be going, no way. She hasn't gotten her last royalty check. But I'm really excited about that.
Yeah,
so that's
I'll be
the
there tomorrow night, 10 p.m. is when I'll be
10
there.
10 p.m. Cheers.
Mm-hmm.
Where
that's,
is that?
That's
located,
120th in Washington in Northland, Colorado.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right up here by where we are at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
So We have cards, we have stage, and thank you for defining what stage is. Stage is when you bring folks up and involve them.
Yep, involve them or do big stage props, cutting a woman in half or, you know, levitations on stage.
Okay, like so I won't be there tomorrow. But I sure appreciate the invite. I'll be busy doing something, washing my hair. No, I'm really excited about the opportunity for you to have this voice to tell folks in our area as well as internationally. So you teach also?
Yep. Only kids though.
Only kids. Mm-hmm. Is that funny? Why?
Because they're the future.
They are the future.
Yeah, if you haven't done it already, then you've missed out.
Okay. And see, I'm the opposite. I teach dance. I say I want to don't. So I go through the back door.
But when I do performances, it's usually, what ends up happening is the parents will hire me for a birthday party for the kid, and then all the adults end up.
Yeah, because they're really just kids. Mm-hmm. But you know what's interesting to me, too, is the two philosophies as teachers, art teachers. I teach people who tell me that life's already told them they can't do it. That's my challenge. They're like, now just a second. Hey, hold on. I was 46 years old when I put on my first pair of dance shoes. I danced for 20-some years, competed, and I'm telling you, if I could do it, anybody
could. I was told when I was a kid that my hands were too small to play the violin.
That's right.
They were too small to handle cards.
Who cares?
Right, exactly.
But I'm glad that you didn't believe him. But, no. You know, you'd be surprised the amount of adults that come to me to learn dance. And I'm like, oh, yeah. Now, Henry, on the other hand, who learned the jig today, I said, Uncle Henry, you want to learn the Irish jig? Well, he was out of that chair.
Right. No, yeah. And what's amazing with adults is that I've actually been hired recently for a couple of events, private events, a great company, CCS, Colorado Cleaning Services. They hired me for their corporate event. And what's amazing is a company like that nowadays, they set a prayer together to bring the night together and have their food and bless their foods. And, you know, to be a part of companies and organizations like that, such as KUHS Denver, yeah, such as TCS, all these different companies that are out there that are bringing me on board. It's so much fun. It's a great experience. And I definitely would try to ask you guys, check out rogermagic.com, send emails that way. There's contacts there for hire. Definitely pricing is negotiable, but, you know, that's definitely.
And here's another thing. Pricing. Folks. You got to pay the man. Sometimes he does charity work. You know, like as a dancer or a teacher or a workshop leader or a writer, folks say, oh, you charge? Yeah, well, I charge.
I was just actually interviewed by a college master student. She's going for a master's degree out in California. And she called me. She says, hey, I need to speak with an artist. And, you know, this friend of Facebook, she's like, would you mind answering some questions for me? And they're looking at doing programs where they can do free studio time for musicians, free different options, different connections, being able to provide connections, which are difficult nowadays. If you don't know the right people, sometimes it's hard to make that opportunity available for yourself. So, you know, programs like that, things like that are just inspirational to know that they're coming out. Schools are offering magic as an option to public speak. And, you know, I mean, it's moving forward. We're moving in the right direction. Arts can never go away. Music can never go away. People think that it's not important, and it's just as important as any other curriculum out there.
That's right. Is there an element, just one quick question before I tell a story. Uncle Henry, I'm going to tell a story here in a minute. What's your favorite magic?
Oh, my favorite magic is close-up magic because I'm right in front of you. I do cards. I'll do a trick for you, and I see that twinkle in your eye.
Okay.
I see them jump 5 feet in the air. I see you run away out the door because you don't know what to believe. There's so much things that people do that are just hilarious. You know, it's addicting. You know, I love seeing people laugh. I love seeing people freak out and run and tell their friends and grab them and bring them. You gotta see this. You know, check this guy out. You know, and it's fun. It's absolutely fun, and you have to have fun with what you do. You can never lose that inspiration, that inner child to grow and learn and challenge yourself to be better at what you do.
And when you talked about competition, it's true in the arts. I think, you know, when you compete, it is about the artist. Mm-hmm. When you perform, it's about the audience.
Absolutely.
Always. If you can't gauge and some of the people who are the biggest producers of some of the biggest dance shows have said that, I don't care if you come to me with a world title. I don't care. If you cannot engage me and bring me into what you're doing and inspire my imagination, which is what you're talking about, Roger.
Well, you know, I know some of the best out there. I know one of the guys that used to rank the best magicians in the world. He's the guy that said, okay, you're number 50. You're number one. You know, so to be that guy, that's something to aspire to. Mm-hmm. I've met him through great friends, through great people, great singers, different artists. Brandon Abeda, great friend of ours here at KUHS Denver. He's pushed out, because of all these different connections that we have, friendships that we ascertain, the social media aspect, things nowadays, it's unreal.
Yeah.
The connections we can have and the impact we can have on people.
And I think, unfortunately, our time's just about out, and I want to tell a story that leads into this, that talks about this. Roger, thank you.
You're so welcome. RogerMagic.com, guys. Thank you so much, Laura, for having me. Henry, thank you for having me here. Guys, always tune into KUHSDenver.com. It's free, easy online internet radio with some of the best music out there and some of the best hosts.
Thank you, darling. And I'll tell you something, we have a fun time.
Of course.
And I'm Laura L. Padgett. And you can reach me, not yet, darling, please. Oh, I know, I love him. I always have to keep Henry on that. Doggone, he won't wear that collar, that shot collar, so I got to verbally say, no. but those of you who've met Uncle Henry, I just adore him. Don't tell my husband. But one of the things that I want to make sure I leave you with is how to reach me. And that is LauraLPadgett.com. And on that website, you will see my publications. You'll see how to get my book, Dolores Like the River, another one coming out in fall called Jesus in Shorts, about short stories of where little moments in God shows up real big. And I also want to tell you about my guest for the 7th of April. Her name is Miss Beatrice Bruno. Beatrice is a drill sergeant alive. Now, Beatrice was, in fact, a drill sergeant in the Army. She's written several books about how to get out of your own way and get what God wants for you. Fabulous nonfiction books. But now she's written a fiction book that is part of a series. It's called The Baby Chronicles. And the tagline to it is, who you were before you were. So this is a fun book. I started it, and it's just a kick in the pants. So that's April 7th, 2 p.m., right here on KUHSDenver.com. Miss Beatrice Bruno, Drill Sergeant of Life, Baby Chronicles, should be talking about. I want to tell you a story, you guys, so sit back, relax. Grab your cookies and milk. If you haven't already, I'm sorry. I'll tell you something. I'm a busy girl. Roger's a busy guy. Uncle Henry's the busiest man on the planet. But I'm always doing stuff. I'm always going somewhere. I've got to be somewhere. So I'm very careful about my time. And today was no exception. And I always get excited about my radio, especially my guests. I've been blessed with wonderful guests for a year and a half. I'm so grateful. But, I have my time planned out, and I have a meeting, and I've got to go get my Starbucks. I got to do that. And everything's going just swell. I left the house on time. My shoes even matched. Just really, the whole symphony was falling into place. All the members of that orchestra playing on time, mm-hmm. on tune. Then I get to an intersection, and boy, howdy, everybody stopped. I look up, all the lights are red. Well, don't you know, just to inconvenience me, the center of the universe, here we have a traffic jam. Policeman gets out of his car, he's directing traffic. I'm like, well, would it, you just know it? Folks, it wasn't a traffic jam. It was a funeral. And I'm sitting there in my car, and I realized it was a funeral. And the hearse went by. And I thought to myself, Father God, you always teaching me lessons. First of all, when I'm not even in the classroom and I'm not expecting them. But here is the lesson I learned today I want to share with you. Everybody's going to end up in that box. The brilliant amphibian Kermit the Frog said, ain't nobody getting out of here alive. He's right. And it gave me a moment, cause to pause. And reflect and say, why the heck am I so busy? And here is the reality. Here is the end stop for all of us. And it isn't about being in a pretty white hearse. It's about what was that life like before. Well, let me tell you what I think. I sat there for almost 15 minutes for cars going by. And I'm saying to myself, here was a life well lived. Here was a man or a woman who had all of these people who are now wishing them well on their journey to their home, to the eternal home. And it really brought me into a peaceful place. I wasn't inconvenienced by the hurts. I wasn't inconvenienced by the problems that traffic gets snarled up when there's a funeral. And I looked around at other people in cars, and they were all just sitting there, placidly, peacefully, somehow an awareness and an understanding that this brother or sister of humanity has now gone on to meet the fate that will find us all. And you know what I thought? I thought, I'm on my way to a meeting that I'm going to go talk to somebody about magic on a day that represents magic. St. Patrick's Day, Ireland, magic, magical people, magical music. And I said, you know, I don't know who that person is, but I hope in their life they experience the magic. Because they're going home now. No. Mr. Magic, please. They're going home now. And there are lots and lots of people wishing them their way, wishing them on their way to that journey. And you know what? I just want to believe that man or that woman came to be, see, share the magic. Thank you, Roger Lopez, magician.
Rest in peace, Ryan.
Yeah, rest in peace, brother, sister. And you know what? We're sending you off with some magic right now. Mr. Magic, late great Grover Washington Jr. Have a magical time. Go see Roger if you can.
Thank you, Laura.
You betcha. Thank you.
Absolutely.
God bless.
God bless you.
We love you. Bye-bye.